It's showing everything up here.
Bring up your presentation, the DI should be hooked up.
But can we take them down? Take the screen down? I don't wanna reveal the cool.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Surprise.
How much money?
He just wants to try out to see if the sound works on his laptop.
On this laptop?
Yeah, and he was trying to pull it up and it wouldn't complain, it just kept on saying error. See, that's what he wants to bring up, the intro, but he doesn't want them to see it. Yeah, so when he hits that, there's a red arrow that comes up.
Like PowerPoint? Yeah.
That's why I didn't know if it's speaker ready or how to do it on the laptop.
Well, if when you plug in the HDMI, it's probably going to try.
So otherwise I can use this.
Okay.
Does the music work?
I don't know. It should work. I feel like the music is probably going to be a spoiler.
No, well, we
don't want to. So you can't extend the desktop because you've unplugged it, and our system needs to have you plugged in for it to work properly.
I'm going to go and check the other rooms.
Oh, it will work.
It will work if you plug it in.
Well, I'm not going to plug it up here. My name is Lonnie Armis. I'm going to chair this session, which is entitled, perfect. Hans, can you just come up and get part of your outfit, please? You're going to be Boba Fett. There's a... No, I got you covered. Okay. You don't need the mask right now, but I figured you might want the... No, there's actually armor right there.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is Star Wars, entitled Star Wars Bronchoscopy, A New Hope. There you go, right? And then this better work. Yes. So this took me like hours. So there's the first faculty part, and then following, this is the sequel. All right. this is going to be great. I'm pretty psyched to do this session. It's going to be fun. We have a great panel of expert speakers in bronchoscopy. So first up, we're going to have Dr. Gerard Silvestri, who's a professor at Medical University of South Carolina, is going to talk to us on, there's obviously, who is not, well, I don't even want to know. How many Star Wars fans are in here? Okay, good. All right. So we've embedded some quotes, so your eyes can deceive you, don't trust them. He's going to talk to us about evidence-based updates on diagnostic yield in the periphery. Just so we don't have to go back and forth, I'm going to just go through and introduce everybody.
Lightsaber.
Yeah. So then we're going to get Alex Chen as Do or Do Not, There Is No Try Advancement. Alex Chen. Yes. Hans Lee, Advancements in Electromagnetic Navigation. So I find your lack of faith disturbing. Does fluoroscopy have a role in bronchoscopy? Dr. Nicole Tanner at Medical University of South Carolina.
You're my only hope.
Alex Chen from Washington University of St. Louis is going to talk to us about real-time ultrasound guidance, needle aspiration in the periphery.
The more wretched hive of scum
and George Chang from Duke University is going to talk to us about transparenchymal nodule. And then Momin Wahidi at Duke is going to talk to us about the robotic revolution.
Remember, the force will be with you.
All right. I'm done with that. So now it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Gerard Silvestri, our Yoda, who's going to talk to us about evidence-based updates and diagnostic yield in the periphery.
Tell him. Yeah.
Boy, that was fun.
Good morning. Well, first, I just have to tell you, when I walked in here, a kind woman came up to me and she said, are you guys going to be talking about robotic bronchoscopy? I said, yeah, I think so, but you may want to ask the chair of the program. And I said, he's right there. And she looked over and she said, oh, I thought he was a tech.
Love it.
I've been trying to get Tim to wear a tie or even a shirt that matches for a long time. So listen, some of you have seen some of these slides. I'm gonna talk to you about the evidence base, and it's something our lab's been really starting to get our arms around. We kind of have this adage in the lab that we're gonna do really strict technology assessment. That's sort of a whole field technology assessment, and we, I don't think, as bronchoscopists, have been really honest about what our yields are. And so I want to take you through the literature. More importantly, I want to spend a little bit of time on the type of studies we're doing. And I want to urge the interventional community to start to up the ante on the types of studies that they're doing. This is my disclosures. None of them are consulting fees or paid research talks. That's all grant funding, both federal and industry. So I want to take you through time, and as you look through these studies, I want to just sort of discuss where we're at. So 2013, let me start at the lower one, the 2012 meta-analysis from our lab, actually, and we're in the process of updating that meta-analysis, but that was 39 studies, 3,000 patients. The yield for bronchoscopy, we stated, was 70% aggregated yield. Lower yield for 2-centimeter lesions and a higher yield for above 2 centimeters. The next year, the ACCP guidelines, 35 studies, 4,000 patients, and they basically said 78% for peripheral lesions, 88% this is overall, by the way, for central and then peripheral. If you looked at the ones by size, they argued for a lower rate, but overall they thought bronchoscopy was pretty good. And the guidelines at that point said, look, you can use navigation, you can use peripheral ultrasound to get to these lesions. So even our guidelines stated this was technology that you could use. Oh, I'm sorry. So now I want to go ahead just 2 years and show you the acquired data registry, which is published in the Blue Journal by David Ost. 15 sites, 531 patients, so a good number in a single collection of data. Flexible bronchoscopy was now a little bit lower, 64%. Radial EBUS, 57%, ENMN, 39%. There's some question about selection bias in this study, and I think it's a legitimate concern. Nonetheless, it was the first signal that said, hey, wait, maybe we're just not as good as we think we are. I was lucky enough to lead the AEGIS trial, which is the bronchial genomic classifier study. And the first thing that happened when I got full data from all the sites was we went and started to look at the diagnostic yield of bronchoscopy. And lo and behold, this is a prospective, now first prospective observational trial, and the yield for bronchoscopy was 53%. I'm going to share some new data with you that will be presented in much more detailed fashion later by one of our fellows late in the afternoon. But that led us to a multi-center randomized controlled trial, the first one I think you'll see in a long time in bronchoscopy, which was led by Nicole Tanner, and we were a site, and Hopkins was a site, Alex Chen over there was a site. So in this study, we had five sites, 221 patients randomized to either standard bronchoscopy with fluoroscopy, look at that, 37%, and thin scope with EBUS, 49%, and in greater than 3 centimeters, it was 57%, but it was lower in lesions smaller than two centimeters. So if you just sort of step away from this and look at it, one prospective registry, two observational trials, multi-centered, you see that the yield falls more into that 50% rather than 70% range. Just to go into slightly more detail, this was the meta-analysis, 3,000 patients, 3,000 lesions. The combination yield ranged from 46 to 86%, 61% for less than 20, 82% for greater than 20 millimeter lesions. Now, look at the pneumothorax and the chest tube rate. So people will look at this in study and say, wait, transthoracic needle biopsy has a 90% yield, but a 15% pneumothorax rate. We have a 70% yield, but look at our pneumothorax rate. Everyone's happy. Let's go home and do lots of bronchoscopy with any type of navigation. And there was no difference by the type of navigation that you use, peripheral ultrasound, EMN, and others. This was published in August of this year. This is the group multicenter prospective randomized trial published in CHEST. You can see the usual suspects, Tanner, Pastis, Yarmus, Chen, Mehta, from University of Florida, and Jessica Wang Memley, who was from our lab and then went over to Washington and actually was part of the meta-analysis when she was a fellow. 214 patients. Lesions were actually 1.5 to 5 centimeters, so not just smallish lesions. And we compared adult standard bronchoscope with ultra-thin with EBUS. Primary outcome was yield. Secondary outcome, radiographic and procedural factors. 37% for standard bronchoscopy with fluoroscopy. I would make the argument that this is the first randomized trial that puts to bed the use of fluoroscopy and standard bronchoscopy for the periphery, puts it to bed. It should not be recommended. It should not be in the guidelines, and it should be a strong negative recommendation. Now 50%, so a coin flip about whether you get it with thin bronch and radial EBUS, the p-value was just a trend, so it was actually not that much better. We did cross over patients, so if you had a non-diagnostic standard arm on ROSE, you could cross over into the opposite arm. So this is data from and by the way, pick up another 15% of patients. This is a study that looks at bronchoscopy and basically states that it's often non-diagnostic. The objective was to evaluate the effectiveness of bronchial airway gene expression classifier, and it was done in 28 centers in the United States and Canada with a large number of patients, 639 patients. First of all, bronchoscopies were non-diagnostic 53% of the time. 35% of the patients with benign lesions underwent invasive procedures. And in an intermediate risk group, that's like doctors were asked, were they at low risk by 10% intervals, their pretest probability that cancer was present. In that group, in the intermediate group where bronchoscopy is recommended in the guidelines for nodules, the non-diagnostic rate for bronch was incredibly high, 83%. Despite a prevalence of cancer of 41%. It's a real problem, guys. We have to own that problem because we're not going to get better unless we don't. Using the classifier, the negative predictive value was 91%. So if you had a non-diagnostic bronch and on the way out you did a brushing and that suggested there was no cancer, you could trust that there was sort of no cancer after that bronchoscopy. So this is new data that's going to be presented in more detail later. We were finally able, 2 years later, to get the data set from the Aegis trial to break down bronchoscopy. And this is what I'm going to end with. Total number, 938. 250 were excluded because they didn't have pretest probability. No documentation of the type of bronchoscopy. We analyzed 687. So this is not the same data set that you saw in Aegis, right? Because we had to eliminate some other patients. We looked at patients with standard EMN, very small numbers, EBUS 300, combination bronchs were 106. Just want to show you this, something very interesting. The overall yield was actually 70%. Good news. Bronch does something some of the time. The problem is, if you didn't think that you had cancer, your yield was only 50-50, right? The higher the probability of cancer, the higher your yield. If you look at the types of bronchoscopy standard with fluoro, it's a coin flip. Now, this is not just for peripheral lesions. This is for everything. It's a coin flip. If you look at EMN, same thing. If you look at EBUS, EBUS does behave really well, and standard plus EBUS behaves really well. If you go to size, again, small sizes, your yield is pretty darn low, right? And then as you get larger, you get better. Again, we're good with central lesions, but not peripheral lesions, 50-50. We're good when they have lymphadenopathy, but not when they're not. There's no difference in sight. So academics and communities are getting about the same yield. So let's take a look now at this. This is sort of the geeky librarian health services research clinical investigator view of all this. The meta-analysis was I started criticizing our own study, and we went back and really started to dig into that study and say, like, could we have been wrong? The number's right, but we didn't put enough contents text around it. Compilation of large single-site retrospective studies. They were done in high-volume centers. of excellence. You had repeat authors among those 39 authors. So you had Asano from Japan, and Oki from Japan, and Hirth from Germany, and you know Wahidi from Duke. So you had these authors that were repetitive, and they were all retrospective single site studies. And when you look at the single sites, I'm sorry, there were relatively small numbers, 50 here, 100 there, right? They weren't big trials. And this was also retrospective, same as above. So those were the two earlier, those were the high yield 70% studies. Now if you go to these other ones, what do you see? Multicenter, prospective, registry, academic and community, large numbers, maybe potentially confounded by selection bias. The multicenter prospective observational aegis trial, academic and community, large numbers, and the endpoints were well-defined, really well-defined. And then the multicenter trial out of our shop, multicenter prospective randomized controlled trial, endpoints well-defined, large N, 200 for a single study, and academic only. So these are some additional observations I want us to sort of take in. First, there was really poor definition of benign disease in many of these studies. And now in the meta-analysis, when we update it, we're not going to include studies that didn't well define what's benign disease. Missing data, inadequate follow-up, so they didn't follow these things up for 2 years or 1 year at least and tell you that it was benign. They just sort of said it was benign, and we're supposed to believe them. Endpoints not clearly stated, and concentrated publications from high-volume centers with special expertise, and that leads to questions of generalizability. So in summary, the evidence suggests to me, if I'm going to be honest, that the yield of bronchoscopy is about 50%, closer to 50% as opposed to 70. High quality evidence from multi-center prospective and randomized trials really actually confirm that, right? They confirm that 50% number. And I think we have to understand the better reasons for the lower yield. Technique, is it technique? It's how we're doing it. Is it technology? Is the technology not good enough? Is it patient selection? Are we selecting the wrong patients who shouldn't have had this in the first place? Patients with a low pretest probability of cancer, for example. The IP community really, I think, has the opportunity, and I would argue the obligation, to start to critically assess old and new technologies using robust study designs. And we need to report our findings, both positive and negative, so that improvements will occur in technology and in patient outcomes can then be realized. So this is our thoracic oncology research group. Nick Pastis does a lot of our technology assessment, Nicole. Ben Bevel is the fellow who's working on that data set from Aegis and will present much more detail with logistic regression analysis later on. And I'm grateful for some slides. Our group just seems to send those around to each other. So thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. We're gonna just hold questions because I think this will lead to a lot of discussion. So just in the interest of time, we'll move on. So it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Hans Lee, who's going to talk to us about advancements in navigational bronchoscopy. He's also fondly known as Boba Fett. Awesome.
He's barely seeing this.
You can, if it's easier for you, you can put the mask in front.
I will take the mask off, because in the movie, Boba Fett doesn't really talk, right? Everyone knows that, so.
I'd say 60% of people.
Okay, well, Boba Fett doesn't talk in the actual movie, so it's my pleasure to talk more about EMN bronchoscopy. These are my disclosures. I've done research and consulting for a navigational bronchoscopy company. And the learning objectives, I'm going to go over more of how to review the EMN literature, what are the pitfalls in it, because there's a lot of trials that are ongoing right now, which will be coming out, and there's a lot of newer changes and upgrades on existing technology, which are currently being studied and will be published hopefully within the next year. But like Gerard kind of mentioned, the characteristics performance of conventional bronchoscopy has not been great, and we've always known this, and we certainly know that size plays a small component of it. Certainly when we go below 2 centimeters, that seems to be a threshold size where we start to see performance drop off. So really no, pretty understandable why bronchoscopy was really left off of the guidelines for many, many years. But one of the things that we do know from data like the National Lung Cancer Screening Trial is that bronchoscopy is a safe modality. So can we improve upon this to have that safety component for our patients, improve on their performance characteristics? And so one of the thoughts has always been, if we saw a little bit better, if we can see what we're trying to biopsy, could our performance be improved? And the idea of CT fluoro has been around for many, many years. It's not a new concept. And there's actually a study, I think a very well done study. It was a randomized study at a single center that already looked at imaging CT fluoro versus conventional bronchoscopy with fluoroscopy. And really, there was really no difference between those two. So that's, fairly interesting information, because if we're saying that it's just imaging alone that is our barrier to getting better performance results with bronchoscopy, certainly this study seems to point to the contrary. So I'm going to pose this question to the audience. Which of the following is a major limitation of diagnostic bronchoscopy? And I'll tell you this, there can be more than one correct answer. Is it nodule movement during respiration? Is it imaging of the nodule during the biopsy? Is it biopsy instrument tools? Is it adjacent or eccentric nodules? Or is it learning and training of the EMN procedures in general? How many thinks there's more than one answer that's correct? How many think it's all of the above? Right? Yeah, absolutely. I think it is all of the above, and you can argue that there's other things that I didn't put up there. But when we look at the literature for navigational bronchoscopy or many of the other things, we very rarely see research and papers being published on many of these factors. So I would argue that our current research has been very focused in certain areas, but not in others. And I think we really need to investigate some of those other areas in order for us to really get better at what we're trying to do. This is one of my favorite cartoons and my arguments as to why pulmonologists or chest physicians should be paid a lot more, because nowhere else in the body are we actually really biopsying a dynamic organ, something that's constantly moving. And certainly, sure, we can paralyze the patient, we can hold respiration for a short period, but again, it's a short period, and there's a reason why breathing is important. You can't live without it. This was a paper that was published by one of my colleagues who's here, Dr. Chen. Looked at nodule movement based on the different lobes. And if you look at the mean movement between the lobes, once I get back there, is that some of these movements are going to be larger than the actual nodule itself. And so definitely these nodules are moving. We can argue a little bit more about how they're moving and how much that affects our procedure. But again, this hasn't been really well studied. So let me get to navigational bronchoscopy. There are three currently available commercially in the United States, and I'll go over a little bit of each of these. But again, all three of these technologies are either undergoing a larger pivotal study, or they have some sort of increase and upgrade in the technology, which is currently being studied and hasn't been published yet. So I think what's really more important for me to talk about is I'll talk a little bit about what those upgrades are, but how to critically maybe assess some of the studies that come out very shortly. So for those of you that aren't familiar with the EMN technology, it's basically projecting or creating some sort of magnetic field around the patient, and then ultimately merging it with some sort of CT scan or some sort of imaging information to give us a little bit more information. And the different technologies and devices may use different types of tools. The way I explain EMN bronchoscopy to my patients is very similar to like the GPS system in our car. It's based on the satellites and around our planet. And we have a vehicle that goes from point A to point B. And then we have some sort of device that we can input where we'd like to go and get feedback as to how to get there. And for our patients, rather than having the satellite, we have some sort of a CT scan information. We have, instead of a vehicle, we have an instrument tool or some sort of guide sheet that gets us from point A to point B. And then, of course, we have software and hardware where we get that feedback information during the case and allow us to input where we'd like to go. So this is kind of a sample of EMN bronchoscopy. If you haven't seen it, you have a virtual image. And then you also, of course, have your bronchoscopic image. But EMN is not new. This was the first case report of EMN bronchoscopy back in 1998. This was actually a surgical technology that was adopted for bronchoscopy. And so this EMN has been around for decades. It's only more recently being popularized in pulmonary because it's finally arrived to us. Again, we know that EMN procedures are safe in general, just like conventional bronchoscopy. So it still has that characteristic that's really, really important. But the problem that Gerard correctly stated is performance. Can we actually improve upon what we have been doing historically? So what to look for in these bronchoscopy studies, I think, that will be coming out very shortly, and also critically reviewing what's already been out there, is really let's look at the inclusion criteria of the subjects in these studies. Are we looking at different size nodules? Are we looking at masses? What was the mean and median value of these sizes? Was there an air bronchogram associated with them? And then most importantly, what is the definition of diagnostic? Because as I comb through the literature, the definition of diagnostic varies quite a bit. And so it's really difficult to compare one study to another. And then ultimately, because we know that bronchoscopy has a very poor negative predictive value, meaning that it doesn't rule out lung cancer, right? We really don't know what the actual diagnostic yield truly is. So for example, if I did 10 bronchoscopies and all 10 people don't have lung cancer or any type of malignancy, and I biopsy all 10 and really don't get cancer, what does that mean? Does that mean I'm a terrible bronchoscopist? Well, some people might say so. Because I shouldn't have been doing bronchoscopy in the first place. But we don't know. And so I think when we assess really the literature and we look at things like yield and things like that, I think we really need to assess how do they actually follow up these results and how do we know malignant is truly malignant? Don't fall to the dark side. That's what Yoda would say. And then how are we learning these tools? Because they're all quite different. Although they all use magnetic navigation, having used a few of them, I'll tell you, in my opinion, the concepts of how to use them are actually quite different, and so is the technique. The superdimension system has quite a bit of data. It's been around the longest, but even with this, although the data seems somewhat consistent, the definitions are quite different as to what's diagnostic, what was the inclusion criteria. So although you can see a slide like this, very, very difficult to compare one study to another. The question always has been, who's the best? This was a meta-analysis, where I think in Gerard's slide at 70% kind of came from. Again, still very difficult to do comparative analysis because a lot of the definitions and inclusions are quite different. So this is the ACQUIRE registry, which again, we have variable results. If you remember our historic results of conventional bronchoscopy, it's not that far from EMN alone. But I think even with that, I think there's a lot of holes in what was actually analyzed, and we need to actually really truly dig deeper beyond what the diagnostic results are. We really do have to look at some of the processes that get you to a diagnosis. So the challenges in interpreting navigational data. Again, this is an abstract, which I know many have been presented here at this conference. But the problem with abstracts is that they're not critically reviewed, and they're subject to change because they're still being analyzed. This is one particular abstract. I'm not picking on these authors or this particular study, because this argument can be applied to really any of the studies that have been done in the past. But here, there's a part that says 12-month diagnostic yield was 73%. Defined as true positive, that's the malignant diagnosis, plus the true negatives at 12 months. And my question is, what is really true negatives, right? Certainly nodules can certainly be malignant. And if you look a little bit further as to what the percentages are, you'll see that there's quite a big difference. I think the true malignant rate was something like 40-something percent. So the true negatives that were actually defined by this particular definition makes up actually a good component of what was diagnostic. So really challenge yourself when you critically look at the literature about what is diagnostic. How's the definition of that? Because it's actually very difficult to do. You know, very much like I think in cardiology, it's actually a good problem that we're having. in that newer technology are evolving a lot faster than our current literature is reporting. So although that prior abstract that I just presented was actually the largest enrolled EMN type of study, it's a registry, but already there's an upgrade on that particular technology. So what we're going to report or are reporting now may already become obsolete because we have newer versions and newer upgrades of that technology. So the literature is always lagging, I think, a little bit behind in this particular field because technology is driving a lot faster than what we can investigate and publish. So the interesting about superdimension is they're adding fluoroscopy into the component of their procedure to improve accuracy. It's an interesting concept in that we're adding another technology, which we have been using for decades, into the navigational platform. And I think that's the current trend of what we're seeing today. And I'll show you some other technologies. Another commercial product is the Varian EMN procedure. It's a little bit different from the superdimension in that they use sensored instruments. But we only have a pilot study that's available, and there's currently an ongoing multi-center study. So we still have to kind of stay tuned as to what those results are. So that's why I'm going to tell you more about how to assess it rather than to actually do it. All right, I'm going to move forward a little bit quicker. The one thing that I will say is that I think imaging with any of these types of technologies, it seems like the closer that we can image the case prior to the procedure, the better, because it looks like many of the biopsies that we are going for do disappear. This was a study that was already published retrospectively that about 7% of our cases were canceled because of the nodules disappearing or decreasing in size. I know George is going to talk more about the Archimedes system, so I'll glance forward on that. But what's old is new again, and we're seeing fluoro being incorporated into navigational bronchoscopy. So although we may feel like this when something's non-diagnostic, I think we got to keep trying. We got to learn from our mistakes and try to improve our performance. Thanks.
All right, thank you. So now it's a pleasure. Well, I got to get the costumes. Hold on. So it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Nicole Tanner. You got to at least put it on for a second.
Yeah, of course. That's just my outfit.
You're the best. She's our Princess Leia. Oh, sorry about the netting. You want me to put that on?
Yeah, just no,
to,
that's thank you.
So Dr. Tanner is going to talk to us about. It's like my favorite day ever. fluoroscopy and bronchoscopy.
I guess I don't have the excuse that I can take it off because it's not a mask. Please, no pictures.
All right.
Too late for that.
Whoever knows how to tweet, feel free.
Oh, my God, please, no. All right, my parents would be so proud. All right, so I want to thank Lonnie for this a very interesting session. And so I was tasked with talking about fluoroscopy, which Hans just went over to some extent. These are my disclosures. I really have nothing related to fluoroscopy on here, but as I alluded to, we have some grant funding and I've done some consulting on technology to try to get to these nodules. So I bring up the title of the talk, I Find Your Lack of Faith Disturbing, which for all of you Star Wars fans out there was from Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope, which was out in theaters in 1977. I was not born then. So hope in the 1970s, I'm going to take you through this a little bit. So this was what it looked like to be published in Chest in 1975. But this was really one of the first studies that looked at fiber optic bronchoscopy. And what the findings showed were that fluoroscopy was a valuable aid in diagnosing bronchogenic carcinoma, since 42% of the tumors were not visible endoscopically and required fluoroscopic control for placement of the biopsy instrument. And that same study, these very simple tables, you don't see tables like this anymore, you see that the tumor was not visible under fluoroscopy. I'm not sure how to get this to move over there. Oh, here. So tumor was not visible under fluoroscopy, and they were able to see it with the fluoroscopy, it was used in 42% of the patients. And so keep on moving. You look at the, oops, sorry, this thing's. technical difficulties. Okay, it's because I got this wig on my head. And so if you look here, they use transbronchial biopsy techniques in all of their forceps biopsies. And the positive cytology yield, not too bad, 69%. Not much has changed. So continuing on in the 1970s, in June of 1976, they looked at diagnostic accuracy in lung cancer and compared different techniques in association with flexible fiber optic bronchoscopy. And they said the superiority of bronchial biopsy over bronchial brushing in peripheral tumors was accentuated when the procedure was performed with the aid of biplane fluoroscopic guidance. And this is the table that kind of shows that, although they really didn't use fluoroscopy very often, when they did, it helped. The last one from the 70s, I again was not born, this is from 1979, biopsy and brushing of the peripheral lung cancer with fluoroscopic guidance. And the conclusions of this trial really were that the results of this study and review of other series, so this was kind of like a systematic review that was done, was that when you couldn't see a peripheral lesion endoscopically, using fiber optic bronchoscopy with fluoroscopic guidance was really important, and you could diagnose cancers 50 to 80% of the time. We're kind of saying the same thing now, aren't we? All right, so have there been any updates? Well, in the Star Wars realm of things, there have been updates. We're up to, I think, Star Wars Episode 9, and we also had the freestanding Han Solo movie. And so similarly, have we changed from augmented fluoroscopy? So if we call this Darth Vader with his single lightsaber, and then fast forward, we've got the triple lightsaber. So that's kind of how I'm thinking about augmented fluoroscopy, which is what we'll talk about next. And so with augmented fluoroscopy, you take a basic fluoro image, which we've all seen before, and you overlay some additional navigational pathways onto your fluoroscopic view in real time. And so this is, as Hans alluded to, for use with some electromagnetic navigational bronchoscopies, and it overlays the pathway onto the fluoroscopic images. So it's available as a standalone system or as an additional add-on software program to some cone beam CT scanners. And so the one that has been presented at this meeting is LungView. That's the standalone. Then Philips, who makes cone beam CT, also has a software package called OncoSuite, which you can use. Siemens has another, I think it's called DynaCT, which is a cone beam CT, and they also have the option of adding in this Syngo Fusion package. So that is where we are at. And so the data for augmented fluoroscopy alone, and I would just highlight exactly what Hans just said, is that this data is all in abstract form, and it can certainly change. But last year at this meeting, Pritchard et al. Presented their results in a very late session about the ability to accurately locate the lesion. And so the purpose of that was just to show that using this augmented fluoroscopy could get to a lesion, and they verified it with cone beam CT. And so in 25 patients with an average nodule size of 2 centimeters, they were able to get to the lesion 100% of the time as compared to cone beam, which is what you might argue is the standard. And you know, cone beam has been used in interventional radiology suites for many, many, many moons. It's also used in neuroangio literature to help localize lesions, et cetera. And so their diagnostic yield, again, take it with a grain of salt, was reported at 92%. There's an abstract that was supposed to be presented here at CHEST, which is a summary of a multi-center experience with this lung vision trial. Again, they use cone beam CT at one site to confirm the accuracy of getting there with this augmented fluoroscopy, and other sites used radial EBIS. There was 200 patients in 6 centers. The average size of the lesions was 17 millimeters, and they were successfully able to locate the lesion 86% of the time, and a reported diagnostic yield, again, grain of salt, because I don't know what the definitions are, was 78%. So if you want to sit in the Millennium Falcon and update what you're doing in your bronchoscopy suite, could there be more? And so this is kind of a picture of all of the technologies being yielded into one. And so if you go to the Siemens website, they will give you a layout and a schematic for how to set up your hybrid operating room, which includes a cone beam CT, an electromagnetic navigational system, and augmented fluoroscopy. That's a lot of stuff, and it's a lot of money. And so what is the evidence for using cone beam plus augmented fluoroscopy plus EMN? There was an article published from a German group back in 2014 of 33 incidentally detected nodules within mean size of 15 millimeters. They were able to get to the lesion 91% of the time and reported a diagnostic yield of 75%. I put up this picture from their publication that shows the same day cone beam scan in panel A versus panel B, which was what was done, you know, prior to patient selection. So you can see the quality of the images from cone beam CT are actually very good. This is just another picture from that publication that shows the integration of the same day in panel A cone beam CT with the navigational platform. I believe they use SuperDimension in this study, as well as the augmented fluoroscopy, which is in panel C, that kind of gives you the line to get to the target. The more recent publication, which actually just came out this month in the Journal of Bronchology and Interventional Pulmonology, was done using the Philips system, the Philips cone beam system, and the aim is listed as determining the safety and the diagnostic yield of image fusion intraprocedurally using both cone beam CT plus augmented fluoroscopy via that software platform. 75 patients, 93 lesions with a median size of 16 millimeters, and they report a diagnostic yield of 83.7%. They did a multiple logistic regression to see if factors like concentric or eccentric, upper lobe, lower lobe, had anything to do with the yield, and the answer was no. Their pneumothorax rate was 4%. This is some pictures from that publication, and you can see in panel A, that's the CT scan that was done for patient selection. B is the cone beam done that day with the software platform outlining it in the blue circle, and then the overlay done with the augmented fluoroscopy. So that's kind of what's out there, and I would just, again, agree with Hans and say that we really need to look at these studies critically and ask for more than just single-center trials, because right now that seems to be all that we have. So I think that, you know, fluoroscopy still has a role in bronchoscopy, and maybe newer platforms with augmented fluoroscopy are promising, but we're still waiting multi-center trials. Hybrid operating rooms, which include cone beam CT and augmented fluoro and EMN, may improve the yields, but you have to think, at what cost? Is your hospital system going to pay for all of that technology so that you can get to a nodule that your interventional radiologist can do 90% of the time? And lastly, we should have some randomized trials. And I thank you for your kind attention.
That is yours to keep. Thank you. So next up, we have Dr. Alex Chen, who's going to talk to us about real-time ultrasound guidance, needle aspiration in the periphery in an abbreviated form.
Yes. All right. I'm going to go quickly. You've heard a little bit about image guidance now with fluoroscopy and CT. I'm going to talk about ultrasound. These are my disclosures. Both of these companies are working on ultrasound guidance. So why is ultrasound important? I think that all the imaging technologies you've heard about already give you a sense of what things look like externally, and so they give you this map, but we also know that finding the right airway to the lesion is only half the battle. You've also got to stop at the right location, because if you don't do that, you're still going to miss it even after you've gone through that work of getting to the lesion. Hans has already pointed out that the targets are moving at the time of biopsy because your patients are breathing, so that's important to know as well. And then anatomical relationships, which you only get with ultrasound at this point, are really important in determining whether or not you're going to get a diagnostic biopsy. I'm not going to go through this again because Hans mentioned it. Here's the thing that I think is really important. I'm always a fan of opportunities to learn during procedures and get more information. And this is one of the most telltale things that you can see. So in terms of the diagnostic yield for peripheral lesions, it's not size, it's not location. It's really the ultrasound image that you get during procedures, which has the greatest influence on whether or not you can get a diagnostic specimen. What I mean by that, here you've got a probe which is completely surrounded by the lesion. There, the diagnostic yield is 80%, and that's been replicated in multiple studies, so I don't really think that that's up for debate too much. That implies that the lesion that you're going after surrounds the airway that you're actually in. In this image here, you see that the probe is here and that the lesion's biased off to one side, and that indicates that the airway that you're in is adjacent to the target that you're trying to biopsy. Multiple studies, again, have shown that the diagnostic yield here is in that 35 to 45% range, so about half. And this is before you even take a biopsy. So when you go in, put your ultrasound probe, you know, for the most part, whether or not your biopsy is going to be diagnostic or not. One of the other things is that, you know, there are many similarities between navigational systems and GPS, but the GPS systems update your location and the maps change depending on where you are. That's not the case with these navigational systems. So I think that they can be very useful for getting you into the vicinity, but if you're navigating off of an older CT scan, things change. Breathing makes things change. And those maps and the airway reconstructions that you get are based on images that were obtained at some point before the procedure. Now, that might be 5 minutes before the procedure, procedure. That might be weeks before the procedure. So we have to understand how that works. If you get out here, and this is an example of getting to a lesion virtually, if you will, if you were to throw the radial probe out there and not see a lesion, that's kind of the truth at that moment in time. More importantly, it can give you information that says you're at the lesion, but maybe you're next to the lesion instead of in the middle of it. And that feedback would allow you to sort of manipulate things and try to get to the center of it if you possibly could. And because you know that if you can get to the middle of it, you've just doubled the likelihood that you're going to get a diagnosis. So finding it's only half the battle. The next thing that you have to consider is, what do you do to biopsy? And we've talked about hundreds of thousands of dollars of systems to get you into the periphery. But once you get there, think about the things that you're actually using to biopsy these lesions. These go back to the 70s, before Nicole was born. And they haven't changed either. So that's one thing that's really important moving forward. And the majority of the literature that's published has been based on forceps and brushes. So if you're not using TBNA right now, that's one of the things that you can immediately do to potentially improve your diagnostic yield, because the literature is there, and it's good literature, randomized controlled data that says when you add TBNA to your current practice, you're actually going to incrementally improve your diagnostic yield. And most importantly, it's not at the sacrifice of a higher complication rate. So that's one thing that you can definitely do. So what are the current challenges with TBNA in the periphery? Well, the yield continues to remain suboptimal. You've heard about that already. I believe that as well. TBNA continues to be underutilized. That paper I showed you is an old paper. That's been around for a while. But despite that, it's still not being done. Why is that? Is it user confidence? Is it technical limitations? Have the instruments been too stiff to get into the locations that you want? What are the reasons it's not being utilized? And one of the things that we don't currently have is real-time continuous peripheral guidance like we have with EBUS TBNA for centrally located lesions. So is real-time guidance in the periphery possible? We published this back in 2009. I think it was a slow day in the bronchoscopy suite. We were just bored, and we decided to make a double-barreled bronchoscope. So we just attached a guide sheath to the outside of a scope, and then we were able to have the ultrasound probe in a peripheral lesion at the same time as we were able to have a biopsy instrument through that. And you can see that here. And here there's a radial probe and there's a needle, and the radial probe is here, and the needle is just represented by this hyperechoic spot scattered in the background. And again, it's a radial image, so you're not seeing the tip of that lesion or the tip of that instrument. You're just seeing it as it penetrates through the ultrasound field in radial fashion. So why might continuous real-time guidance be good? Well, it'll provide procedural feedback. It's always nice to know if you're biopsying the right location. That's not something that we currently have. It can also improve confidence with TBNA. So if confidence is a reason you're not doing it because you're not sure if you're in their periphery, getting that additional feedback that, yes, I can see it, I can see my instrument at least in the right general location, that's something that might improve or enhance one's likelihood of doing peripheral bronchoscopy, and may it actually improve diagnostic yield. So how would you do it? So we don't have double barrel bronchoscopes anymore, so we've got to combine things into catheters, and when we start doing that, it makes catheters kind of tight, unflexible, and that's not very helpful when we're trying to biopsy upper lobe lesions and things in the superior segment. So what could we do? Combining all these instruments into one, we've got to make sure that it's small enough to fit down our smaller bronchoscopes. The ultrasound's got to provide an equivalent image to what we're used to seeing. So if you're really used to looking at radial ultrasound, it can't be a new learning curve after that. And the needle's obviously got to be visible within the field. So this catheter was developed and combined intravascular ultrasound, which our cardiology colleagues use, and a 25-gauge needle within the sheath. So if this is the sheath out here, this is the IVUS probe, and then the ultrasound needle. Yes, thank you. That goes out into the area when you're taking a biopsy. And this is a benchtop image right here where the IVUS probe is in the middle, and this hyperechoic spot here represents the needle within that ultrasound field. So we did this pilot and feasibility study. Lonnie was an author, as was Gerard and Nick, who would have made a fantastic Chewbacca. Yep. We targeted lesions peripheral 1 to 7 centimeters. The endpoint of the study, this is simply feasibility. This is just to say, can we cram all this stuff into a catheter and see if it actually will go everywhere in the lung? Because again, if it doesn't hit the upper lobe, apical segments or superior segments, it's really not a useful tool. So that was our main endpoint here. We also wanted to make sure that it was as advertised and you could see the needle in the ultrasound field, and then see if there are any adverse events from using this type of technology. So results here, 24 nodules were accessed in 23 patients. Nodules in all lobes were accessed. The majority of the lobes were actually in the upper lobe, so that's, we were actually happy about that. Again, we didn't control for size. We are not, this is not a yield study. We're not trying to get nodules that are 1.5 centimeters. We just wanted to see if this thing would actually work. So this is an example of one of those lesions. Results here, lesion confirmation was obtained in 24 out of 24 patients, meaning we could actually physically get the probe into contact with the lesions and get a view. Needle was visualized in all of those patients as well, and here are examples of that. So for this lesion, the left upper lobe, this is what that looked like. This is a fluoroscopic image here. This is the IVUS probe with the lesion around it, and again, this hyperechoic shadow here represents the needle within that space, and it's a 25-gauge needle as well. So study observations, the catheter was flexible enough to access to all lesions throughout the lung. Ultrasound visualization of the needle and lesion were adequate. Movement of the needle across the ultrasound plane enhanced needle visibility. So it's like EBUS TBNA, where sometimes you have a hard time picking up the needle, and once you move it, you can see it. The reason that it's important here to move the needle back and forth and see that dot appearing and disappearing is because that's the only way you know where the tip is. This is not a linear scanning radial probe or ultrasound probe. So the only way that you know where the tip is if you see it and you pass it across the ultrasound plane each time. And we thought that was important. The catheter was also able to be rotated to affect needle trajectory. So with this catheter system, the needle comes out to one side. So if you don't like where it is initially, spinning it allows you to reposition the needle to give you a different trajectory into the lesion. Whether that's helpful for more eccentric located lesions, we don't know yet, but that is kind of the idea there. So next steps here, hybrid catheter really needs to be evaluating the optimal patient population. And this is one of the most important things with all these new technologies. This is pilot and feasibility. In terms of yield, you can't get a signal from this. So what we really need to do is evaluate this in the targeted patient population in order to make any kind of claim about yield. And then if we want it in guidelines, recommendations that are a bit more firm, we need to have a comparative trial like what you saw with the transbronchial lung biopsy. So next steps will be put it in patients, nodules 1 to 3 centimeters in size. Maybe we can start looking at things like yield or have a better estimation of what might that be in this patient population. And as I mentioned, we really need comparative studies after that. So conclusions. Peripheral bronchoscopy for lung nodules continues to be a challenge. I think that has been a theme of this session so far. Locating lesions is really only half the battle. It's really about what you do once you're out there as well. Lesion confirmation by ultrasound can really predict success, and I think is really important whether or not you're using augmented fluoroscopy or other types of external imaging also. TBNA currently improves the diagnostic yield and is available, so that's something that you can immediately do right now if you're not doing it. And continuous real-time guidance combining TBNA and ultrasound is feasible and may assist with peripheral lesion biopsies moving forward. Thanks.
That's right. Dr. Chen, can you just grab your, I apologize, you were the stormtrooper, so yeah. Thanks, we'll get pictures at the end. All right, so to move along quickly, Dr. George Chang is going to talk to us about, in 5 minutes or less, transparenchymal nodule access, and he is C-3PO.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. So, here we go.
I got you.
You got it. All right, so making this talk quickly about quick disclosures, I participated in these two trials and consult for Medtronics. When I heard stay on target, this is what I got from YouTube.
Stay on target. We're too close.
And they keep on going and going, and sometimes when you're doing the electromagnetic navigation, that's how you feel. You're trying to stay on target. And special thanks to the following people for the slides. So this is the problem that we face as bronchoscopists. We're the prisoners of the airway. What if the nodule is outside the airway? What should we do? And we know that there's CT bronchus sign, and this is one of the key variables that determines the yield. In multivariate analysis, it's independent of the nodule size, navigation success, and anatomical location, and the yield changes from 80% to 30% with no bronchus sign when it's noted. This is also kind of hinted at when we don't have CT bronchus sign and we cannot get a concentric view when we are on a radial EBUS, we also observe this, that our yield decreases. Again, 80% down to 40%. So we're probably going to only have our chance of getting the yield is only about half as good when we actually are not in the middle of the lesion. Now, how commonly does this happen? In this trial of 1,000 individuals, we see that the peripheral nodule of the where the location of the nodule is in the periphery or the middle of the lung third is about 97%. About half of it is less than 20 millimeters, and about half of it, only about half of it had a bronchus sign. So it's actually quite a common issue. So these are the two platforms that currently exist, to help us to get outside of the airway and try to get to the nodule of question. So one of the platform is cross-country platform. The other one that we speak about is going to be Archimedes platform. So let's go visit a cross-country platform. This platform works with a super dimension. As you all know, that we use a CT scan. We do a planning a navigation around, and then we perform navigation. The patient sits within realizing a magnetic field, and that field provides feedback for us to know what the location of our tools. And let me just start this video. Where's my, need to fast forward. Okay. All right, so I'm gonna skip that video quickly. And this is the only study that's been published regarding this tool's feasibility and safety, roughly about 14 patients. As you can see, the two, once you navigate to the location, you provide a guide wire through to target the nodule, then you feed a dilator through the guide wire, and then using Salinger technique, you feed the catheter through the out to achieve outside the airway to target the nodule. In this case, I just want to note that the success for this procedure was only about 75%. And also, I also point out that it's only 12 patients. Now, let's talk about Archimedes platform. I'm going to jump forward a little bit. So think of this as non-EM-based, but a fluoroscopy-based system, where we take the CT scan and we take the CT scan from the patient. We identify the blood vessels, we define the target, and the system automatically calculates the path to the target. The target it shows bright green within the lumen, and then dark light green outside the lumen. It tells you how close you are as we navigate closer to the nodule. Now, how do we go outside of the airway? We pick an area at the point of entry, and entry is entry into the lung parenchyma. So that's where the POE stands for. So this is using vascular. The reason we pick the vessels is that you can do virtual Doppler to show where the relationship between the vessels and your airway wall. And that's where you're going to pick that point of entry, and so that you can go out, so you don't go into a blood vessel. So again, how do we do this? We use a needle punctured through the airway wall. So after you select the appropriate point of entry, then you insert a balloon to dilate, and then you insert the sheath after the balloon, and then you navigate via fluoroscopic guidance. Now, in keeping of the Star Wars, imagine that nodule is your Death Star. Imagine yourself as a white-winged pilot, and you are just trying to get to the Death Star. So these are the tools that you have available. It's the 18 core needle, the balloon dilator, and also the sheath. I'll quickly review some of the history and the evidence behind this. The very first study was done in a canine model with an N of 4 and looking at creating 13 tunnels. And it is very descriptive. Suffice to say, the procedure only lasted about 15 minutes. And if you notice that the distance from the nodule they had, or rather the fiducial marker that they placed to target whether you can actually target the fiducial marker, you can go at very close to the pleura, 0.1 millimeters. Right up there. Following this, another study was done. The investigators use a canine model, and this time they use a calcium hydroxypyrrole, or also known as Ritinese. Basically think of a calcium impregnated in methylcellulose to simulate actual pulmonary nodules. And effectively, the diagnostic, and when you biopsy these nodules that are bronchoscopically placed in the periphery of the lung, you can actually evaluate your bronchoscopic samples to see whether you can actually observe the calcium hydroxypyrrolate. And the diagnostic yield in this case goes up to about 90%. And again, no pneumothoraces, no complications, and minimal bleeding. So the very first in-human trial was done with 12 patients. These are the patients who have a lung nodule who are scheduled to go for surgical resection. So transparenchymal nodule access was performed right before the surgery. Suffice to say that there are actually a couple patients. I apologize. the table did not project correctly, but there are two patients that they were not able to actually perform this procedure. Again, these this is because of the location of the nodule. The left upper lobe is an issue for point of entry selection because the great vessels that are around it. So that's something that you need to keep in mind. Now, again, bronchoscopic, looking at the more most recent publication, six people recruited, and this is to just to show the safety that you can do this in an endobronchial unit. EAST2 trial is ongoing, and I hope I didn't use too much time, but I do want to play this. So remember, one thing that I realized after seeing this is that stay on target guy called Pops, he actually got shot down and he got destroyed. So hopefully, parenchymal navigation is not going to be the guy that, the Pops. Hopefully, we're going to be Sky Luker. Young Luke Skywalker. The young Jedi in this case did destroy the Death Star. And I hope I could have fast forwarded this, but effectively, you guys know how this ends. The tumor gets ablated. All right, thank you guys.
All right. Thanks everybody. Sorry, we're behind, but we'll keep rolling here. So Dr. Wahidi, who's Darth Vader.
Oh.
Is going to talk about updates in robotic bronchoscopy.
Okay, I'll do this for a minute so they can take pictures. Thanks, Lonnie, for inviting me.
You probably could.
I can see actually breathing. Thanks for inviting me. Thanks for all the other speakers to leave me 1 minute to talk about. So kind of you. I'm staying here, so nobody's leaving. I'll make this short, though. These are my disclosures. Importantly, I have consulted with the makers of the robots, but that was early on. I've not been working with them for the last year. So I'm going to skip through this. Gerard, everybody covered this, the current yield and why we care about new tools. But I think if you, just to summarize what everybody said, why do we have a modest performance of the current technology is because we rely on chest CT, which is not real time. We have respiratory variation. The nodule, as George just showed you, not always in the airways. And we can't always really maneuver the tools in the periphery. So can the robots solve these problems? I think Hans showed those two, one of those five issues that he mentioned. So reliance on chest CT, not really. We're still relying on navigation for the most part to get the CT and get to the nodule. Respiratory variation, robots have not solved that problem. Location of the nodule, maybe. The robots may increase our peripheral reach, so this is sort of a wash, maybe, we'll see. And I think this is where the robots probably will excel. It's kind of maneuvering the tools in the periphery, where we're able to have more freedom of movement, much better than our hands and our tools, perhaps. So what are the potential advantages of the robot? There's definitely more precision. There's a higher degree of movement in the periphery of the peripheral guide sheath and the tools. And more importantly, the ability to hold the endoscope or catheter in a locked curved position, allowing our tools to stay on target without the straightening that currently affects other systems. We see that with other navigation systems. You navigate to a place, but then you pull your sensor or tool, and then it straightens out. So the robot will hold that tool in place. Disadvantages, it has not solved the issue of finding the best path to the lesion. That's still a big, big issue. We don't have tactile feedback or haptic feedback. This is problematic for us. We don't know how much to press. I think both robot systems have some sort of a number to give you kind of an idea of the pressure. There's a steep learning curve. Everybody's saying, oh, the new generation will do this fine because they play video games. Well, I think the mid-career, like myself, we'll see. I think we played video game. It was Atari, but we can learn this. And then the cost, which I'll mention a little bit here at the end of the talk. So two currently available systems, the Auris Monarch, which is a robotically propelled outer sheath with an inner telescoping endoscope. Again, it uses electromagnetic navigation for guidance. You use this joystick or handheld controller, And it has optical capability in a separate suction channel. And this is the only data published that we know about. Feasibility study, 15 patients from Costa Rica, single institution, peripheral lung nodules with a bronchus sign, so easier target, no adverse events, biopsy obtained in 93% of the patients, cancer in 60%. This is honestly just a feasibility study, has no meaning because highly selected single institution has no meaning whatsoever other than we could do it. The other system is Intuitive. This is an articulating robot-assisted catheter. They're not using navigation system. Yeah, they're using what they call shape-sensing technology. Supposed to be better. We don't know that. That's to be validated. And so other technical details I'll skip because of the time limitation. Also, we have one study from Australia, where they did 30 subjects with a bronchus sign. Notice they're always having the easier targets, but those are feasibility studies. EBUS confirmed, radial EBUS confirmed, diagnostically at 83%, no adverse events. Once again, meaningless study, just feasibility, doesn't give us any information about diagnostic yield yet. So a little bit of a new technology adoption. This is sort of the business world kind of little curve. So there's the innovators, there's the early adopters, then the early majority, late majorities, and then laggards. So you, every one of you in this room is going to fall in one of those category. So you could be an early adopter, like those people that line up the Apple stores and get the first iPhone for $1,000. What? The current iPhone is $1,000. You have it. See, he's an early adopter. But early adopters can also be disappointed. This was the first flat TV. And if you bought that, there was a lot better flat TV 5 years later. So you never know. The iPhone kind of stood, but the flat TV did not. I love this. This is the hype cycle of emerging technology. So first, you have the peak of inflated expectations. And we are certainly here. And there's the trough of disillusionment. Coming shortly to a theater near you, and then then the slope of enlightenment, I like that, and then the real-time product realities. This is business, not just robots. This is really what happens in every new product. So welcome to the peak of inflated expectations. So this is something to be educated about. This is what we call the curse and the blessing of 510K clearance. If you don't know what that is, this is a submission by a device manufacturer to the FDA to demonstrate the device can be marketed because it's at least as safe and effective as an already device available in the market. So it does not require data for approval. So it's a blessing sometimes because it gets you a technology quick. However, the curse is that there's no data required. And so what do manufacturers do then? They're not going to sponsor any study, or maybe some studies. But there's no direct comparative studies. Data about yields and values are weak and inconsistent, usually single centers like you just saw. Some gee whiz, I've done 50 patients. We've seen some of those in this conference. Then there's hesitant and lukewarm endorsement from national societies, guidelines, physician community. Really no good data to have a reimbursement by payers or recognition by the payers of new technology. So, got to remind ourselves we're in a value-driven healthcare environment right now. Believe it or not, even if you're living in a cave, every commercial payer now is pushing your hospital to have some risk-sharing and cost accountability. So we are moving, for sure, to value-driven healthcare. And in that value-driven healthcare, the value equation, outcome of cost over cost, is extremely important. So where's robotic bronchoscopy in the value equation? Currently, the cost is very high. The outcomes are questionable. That doesn't mean they're not good. That means we need to really do good studies to prove that the outcomes is good and that the value equation is actually meaningful. So my summary is I think we still need more technology, and we actually want to encourage industry trying to find those technology for us. But we need to really be mindful and do research and prove the value. And is robotic bronchoscopy the answer? We don't know yet. It may not. And then finally, for the early adopters, I have another tool for you. GI used it. Our usual colonoscopy equipment is down today, so we're going to be using a tapeworm with a GoPro strapped to its head. So perhaps we have something for the airways, a GoPro maybe over, I don't know, something else. Lonnie will think of it for next conference. So thank you.
All right. Thanks, everybody. So we actually have, there's not anybody coming right in, so if anybody wants to stick around, we can take questions and have a discussion. Yeah. Does anyone have any questions? Otherwise, we'll. So I'll just start the discussion. Can I just, from a panel perspective, can you guys just talk a little bit more about the steps needed to help appropriately validate these newer approaches before we all turn into early adopters? What was it? The early disappointed adopters? Yeah.
So, you know, we need those first studies, those first-in-man studies, the animal studies. I think that's just proof of principle, and it's incredibly important. I then think we do a good job of going to the single-site studies. I think we're very good at that, right? You know, the companies will set people up in their own place to do 25 or 50 cases, and we need those, too. They tell us that this actually works and give us a little bit of a safety profile. Unfortunately, that's where it seems to stop. And, you know, the randomized trials are not the end-all, be-all. But the next step is to get to multi-center trials and multi-center prospective trials, whether they be randomized or not, so that we know that, look, it's not just done well in Felix Hirth's shop, it can be done in many other shops. So getting to this point where we're doing multi-center trials that have prospective, well-defined endpoints, and I can't emphasize the endpoint piece enough. We don't define our endpoints well, and quite frankly, the IP community is really not well-positioned to design trials, and I would urge people at their home institutions to get somebody from a clinical trials design shop involved in their trial design and a statistician up front. And then the last piece is, truly is a randomized trial, because then we'll know whether we can shelve old technology and move towards new technology. I think where we tend to stop in this community, and the only thing that's going to raise the profile of the interventional pulmonary community is when we recognize that we're doing this, we seem to stop at single center retrospective trials. So that would be my take on that. And by the way, those cost money and funding is needed. And I think the IP community also hasn't pushed back enough to industry. Industry always seems to be able to find one of us that'll do a single site study in our institution for essentially free. And until the IP community says, look, that's not good for you or us. Honestly, it's not good for anybody. Why don't we get a group together and do a well-designed trial? Might cost you a little bit more, but doing these single-site trials is going to be penny-wise and pound-foolish in the future, because I don't think, and Lonnie, those slides are beautiful, I don't think payers are going to continue to pay for this without that.
So let me ask, since we have the, what's your ex officio president, extraordinaire? So what do you think the role of societies are in that level of both opportunity and obligation to help make that happen?
Yeah, so that's a great question, because I've been asked when I was in the role, and now I'm immediate past president, which really means I get an incredibly small room in a bad hotel next year. We were approached by industry a lot about how can we help them get their technology, doesn't matter the name, doesn't matter, it's not cancer related, into the guidelines. That's the first place, right? So there's this like, if we could just get in the guidelines, payers would see the light, and you know, the problem there is I'd have to gently say, hey, look, like, we love working with you guys, and I think our society would approach that, except you got to show the evidence. You can't get into the guidelines without them being evidence-based, and these guideline panelists generally are pretty tough, and they're methodologists, so they're going to look at this and say, okay, well, here's the grid, here you go, retrospective one-site study. That means, like, no, it's not going to get into a high-quality evidence review. So That's one aspect. The other aspect is that I think societies can play a role, and I do believe this, and I've tried to work with our society in the education piece, right? So the education piece is our responsibility, and so educating people on technique, and I think it was Hans who brought up the technique piece of this. You know, we do have to educate our learners in techniques. After that, we have small grants that can work within the college. One of the nice sort of Lonnie ideas was, well, why don't we have a central clearinghouse with grants so the grant comes into a place like a society or college or a large group of investigators like RTOG for cancer or one of those. I love that conceptually. Trying to get people in to fund that sort of thing is a bit more difficult. One of the real disadvantages, one of the sad things for us is we don't really have a home at the NIH, right? Like, I apply for lots of federal funding through DOD, NIH, and everything else. It's quite difficult, I think, to get a randomized trial. And so I feel for us in that regard through federal funding. I think that's a problem.
Great, thanks. Any questions from the audience? Otherwise, I think we could adjourn. Okay, great. Thank you, everybody, for sticking around. Send me your
My flight just got delayed by half an hour. I'm worried.
Wait,
about
are you
the
going through Charlotte?
No, I'm flying to Atlanta.
Oh, yes, Atlanta is a bad choice. Yeah. I'm going through Charlotte.
All right, yeah.
We gotta go to a hotel. Oh, a picture. Okay. Where is mine?
Well, you know what? I also have.